Welcome to H2K Infosys. H2K Infosys is a e-verify business based in Atlanta, Georgia, United States. We provide 100% job-oriented, instructor-led, face-to-face, true live online software training programs. It also includes access to cloud test lab with software tools. We provide live project for you to work on. We also provide assistance with mock interviews, resume preparation and review, and job placement assistance. H2K Infosys is trusted by so many students across the world. H2K Infosys provides world-class services in IT training with real-time project work for corporates and individuals, special IT training for MS students in the United States, software design, development, QA manual and automation, performance testing and maintenance, IT staff augmentation, job placement assistance and tech support.
So those stuff are related to AOP module, and it will consist of several classes. That are related to the cross-cutting concerns. And AOP module is a startup one for introducing metadata programming. Metadata programming, nothing but your annotations. With 2.5 version, Spring has introduced annotations. That means they have reduced the effort for configuration XML file. And you can simply configure the properties or the annotations within your POJO classes itself. 2.5 and above, they are all annotation supported. The next module is JDBC and DAO module. JDBC, let us take a look at small example. Normally, when we want to write a basic JDBC connection, let us say I want to retrieve some kind of employee details. Employee details, select star from employee. This will retrieve all the information from employee table, and I'm iterating by using result set and printing the data. Let us execute this one. You are able to retrieve the data, and finally, with finally block, you have closed the result set and you have closed the statement and you have closed the connection. You are supposed to close all those modules properly, or else your, if at all, if the connection was not released properly after several connection attempts, after several requests, your connections will get full and you're going to get connection not available exception. If you take a look at the code with our raw JDBC code, you are going to write SQL exception handling, and you are going to write the connection closing, and with connection close also you might get an exception. So you are going to write try catch at this level, also, and during statement close or connection close. So instead of you writing or working on the business logic code, you are supposed to have a try with a resource, try catch block for even for connection closing or result set closing. So you are going to write so much of the boilerplate code instead of concentrating on the business logic. The Spring JDBC module, JDBC and DAO module, they have written set of classes or interfaces. They have provided set of classes or interfaces by which you can make use of them to directly contact the database and execute that query. You'll just specify this is my query and I want to use Spring JDBC, and that will query the database and it will directly provide the response in terms of an object representation. It's not required for you to write any kind of exception handling, connection closing or statement closing or result set closing or any of these stuff. It's not required for you to perform. The JDBC module, it has the internal capability of handling the exceptions. See here also, you won't get the exception in detail. You will get only single exception, SQL exception. It can be any kind of stuff, like you might have missed the column name, or you haven't specified the column name properly, or you are not passing the parameters for prepared statement properly. For everything, you are going to get SQL exception only. You won't get any kind of detailed exception information. But with JDBC module, they have defined plenty of exceptions, and they are going to provide the actual content in the exception message. And it's not required for you to handle any kind of exceptions as well. And it will also provide some kind of transaction management as well. With RajDBC, you are supposed to start a transaction and execute those methods. And if you don't want the transaction to be committed, you are supposed to explicitly specify the rollback operation on your own. Here, you can just make use of the JDBC template. JDBC template, this module was developed on top of your RajDBC. That's the only change. And the next one is OR mapping integration module. The OR mapping module, Spring doesn't have any OR mapping on its own. It will provide the integration support to available open source ORM frameworks. See, currently we have plenty of open source frameworks for our ORM. We have JPA, we have Hibernate, we have Hibertus, and also TopLink. Spring provides support for all these ORM modules. Spring has dedicated classes, just like the driver class, which is dedicated for the database. Spring also has the dedicated template classes for each and every open source framework. You can just make use of that particular mapping module and you can configure Hibernate within your application itself. The next one, web module. Web module, as you can see, it was built on top of the application context module and it is used for web oriented tasks. In the sense, whenever we want to retrieve any kind of multi-part request, nothing but when you want to retrieve or when you want to upload any kind of big file, it's not possible for us to upload at a single shot. You need some kind of chunking at that level. So those kind of efforts will be provided by your web module. And the last one, MVC framework. We already know about MVC framework, but this is not same as that of our Struts MVC framework. Spring has a full feature support for MVC itself. It follows its own MVC architecture, has a detailed design for MVC architecture, and we are going to learn MVC framework in tomorrow's class. And your MVC framework and web module has the capability of integrating with Struts framework as well. So that means you can use the IOC pattern, inversion of control pattern from Spring framework, and you can contact the struts action module by using Spring Plus struts application. We are going to discuss about the core module. In today's class, we'll only deal with standalone application. In tomorrow's class, we'll see how to integrate with normal web container or application container. Let us create a small application, Spring application. New Spring project. You can create a normal project as well if the plugin was not available, because we are going to download all the jar files on our own and put it onto the build path. Specify the name and click on finish. Yeah, I guess. For Spring application, you just need to configure all the jar files. So I have asked you guys to download the jar files. I'm not sure, Jitin. So place the jar files onto our build path. Once after that, create a small class. But before that, we need to have a contract first. Define a contract. I'm going to write a small application, a small class, Hello World interface. Hello World interface. Now write a small class, Hello World, which implements our contract. So in Hello World, I'm just going to display a message, private string message. I'm going to create setters and getters for this. So let us declare these two methods in our interface. This is a simple Java file which consists of a property and setters and getters. Now we want to create an object for our Hello World, because we want to know what is the message that was available or how we can set the message. But when we have the Spring framework, it's not required for us to create any kind of object on our own. We just need to configure about our bean class within Spring XML file. Spring configuration file. The root element for this is beans tag. This will consist of the child element, number of beans. We can have any number of beans within our bean's root element. This is root element, and bean, it represents the individual bean. It has plenty of attributes. The important attributes are ID and class. Here class represents your actual class file detail, nothing but your fully qualified class name. ID represents the object name with which we can ask the Spring framework. You can have any number of beans within your Spring framework. You can write one more bean at this level, just like this. If you want to write one other bean, just like your employee bean, you can configure that one also like this, and finally close your root element. But for any kind of bean, ID and class, these are required attributes. Once you have defined this beans XML file, see, you can have any kind of name for your XML file. Once you have declared all your beans within configuration file, you are going to use Spring Core module to provide the support for all your beans. In your core module, there is an interface called Bean Factory. Your Bean Factory acts as a container for all your beans. That means your Bean Factory will read the XML, internal architecture will read the XML file, and it will create instances for all your beans. And you can ask the Bean Factory, hey, I want hello world bean, and the ID for that is hello bean. So that means you are going to configure the ID as hello bean within your XML file. Once you have mentioned that to the Bean Factory, your Bean Factory understands that, yeah, I have this bean available, and I'll create an object for you, and I'll provide the object directly to you, and you can directly use that bean. Once you got the bean, you can use the bean object, bean reference, and call your method. You have informed the Bean Factory that I want a bean with this ID. Bean Factory, what it has done, it has created an instance for this particular object or for this particular class, and it has directly provided the object to you. Ultimately, our aim is to get a reference for the object. You got the object reference now, and you can simply call the methods once you got the object reference. Exactly, we are supposed to inform to the Spring framework by using XML file. We won't call that as a registration. So now come back to our Spring framework and create a resources source folder. And create one Spring XML file. Here you can see that Spring Bean configuration file. Select that one, name that as spring.xml. You can create a normal XML, but you won't get this particular top level namespaces. That's the reason I have selected that. If you don't have that, you can simply Google that one for the namespace Spring configuration namespace, you are going to get that particular detail and incorporate the namespace with your beans root tag. So here you can see that beans is your root element. Within beans, you are going to specify the individual beans. For bean, click a control space, you will see all the remaining attributes, all the attributes that are available. The first one is class attribute, which should point to your fully qualified class name. Currently, my class name is com.hello.helloworld. And I am giving the ID as hello bean. So now I have configured my bean in Spring XML file. That means I have informed the Spring container about this particular bean to take care. Now write a client code, nothing but our main method, com.hello.orTest. Hello world test program. So in main method, we are supposed to use our core module, nothing but our bean factory, and you need to ask the Spring framework to provide the object. I have already placed all the jar files within my build path. So you can see that I am able to see the bean factory. The bean factory is available in a package called org. Spring framework beans.factory. All the jar files, if you guys verified already, all the jar files, they are available with org.spring framework, and you can see that all the remaining modules, once after that, AOP module, aspects, beans, context, core, JDBC, JMS, ORM, transaction, web portlet, servlet, and struts. So all class files, they will start with org.spring framework and the corresponding module. Bean factory is an interface. There is a lower level one, which is XML bean factory. The XML bean factory, it will read the XML file, and you are supposed to specify the resource. Currently, our resource is our spring.xml file. To specify the resource, there is one another class. Class path resource. Which accepts the name of the file. The class path resource, as the name suggests, it will verify for the resource in class path. So currently our resource name is spring.xml file, and it will look into the class path. Currently the spring.xml will be added to your class path because I have specified that in my resources folder. Once you got the factory, nothing but it will get all the information about your Spring XML file. Once you got the factory, this is your bean ID. Go and get the bean based on a method called getBean. This is hello bean. So the hello bean is a reference to हेलो वर्ल्ड इंटरफेस। जस्ट ए मिनट देते हैं। हेलो ऑब्जेक्ट, हेलो ऑब्जेक्ट, नाउ आई गॉट द ऑब्जेक्ट। सो आई एम गोइंग टू कॉल सेटर मेथड और गेटर मेथड। दिस टाइम आई एम डायरेक्टली कॉलिंग गेटर मेथड। The factory.getBean, it will refer a top level which is nothing but your object class, because factory doesn't know what kind of object that it is referring based on this particular ID. It might return an employee or it might return an hello world or some other class as well. That's the reason it will return the top level one, and it is your responsibility to downcast to the required one. Currently I'm pointing to the next level one, which is interface level. You can simply convert this to normal object as well. There won't be any issues. I'm printing the object as well here. Yep.
Why we are taking the interface? Because if there is another class which is implementing that interface, will there be any issue?
I'm sorry, can you please repeat?
What I'm saying is an interface can be implemented by multiple classes, right?
Yeah.
So in this example, we have taken the Hello World interface being used by the Hello World. Maybe there is another class called Hello something, Hello World 1.
Okay.
Which is also implementing the Hello World interface, which can do it, right?
Okay.
So, why can't we be very specific here, saying that instead of putting the Hello World interface, we could have put Hello World?
But at the object level, the right side creation, we are specifying only the Hello World. So, even though if you have implemented a new object or new class for your Hello World interface, there won't be any issue if you are referring to the actual class itself. This is just like superclass reference is pointing to subclass object. That's what we are following.
So what is the advantage? My question is only, why are we doing like this here?
No, there won't be. See, we are supposed to follow the contract at any time, right?
Okay.
The business application, you are supposed to work only at the interface levels or at the top level only, but not at the class levels.
Okay, so we should not do Hello World here in the left hand side.
We can. There won't be any issue. You can go ahead and write Hello World.
Okay.
But any kind of application when you are working, you should be specific to the top level only. That is normal design approach.
Okay, I got it.
Yeah. So now we are asking our Spring to provide an object of Hello Bean. Let us see, at least we are getting the object or not, then we'll go ahead with get message. Let us run the program. Load bean definitions. Loading XML bean definitions from class path resource spring.xml. It was able to locate the file. Let us know specifying springs.xml. You can see that there is a parsing error. It was not able to locate the file itself. Let us say I am referring some other bean which is not available in the XML file. No bean named Hello Beans is defined in the XML file. So you should be more specific when you are referring to the class file, sorry, when you are referring to XML file, or when you are referring to the bean name as well.
So many of our students have given testimonials on how our training programs are. You will find them on kudzu.com and on our website h2kinfosys.com. On our website h2kinfosys.com, you will also find more detailed information on who we are, the courses that we offer, what each course covers. Also, if you're interested in a demo program, please register on our homepage on the left-hand side. Just give us more information about yourself and we will send you a link for a demo class. The demo class is absolutely free. Experience our commitment by just attending an orientation workshop at no cost. Our team of faculty and advisors are here to guide you with the right information. If you still have more questions, please feel free to call us. Call us at 770-777-1269. This is a United States number. If you're calling from the UK, call us at 020-337-17615. You can also email us at training@h2kinfosys.com or h2kinfosys@gmail.com. Thank you for watching our videos. We wish you a great career in information technology.